close to scooping wine. To be the light, oh baby, and unlock your back door. I'll be coming through that waiting out to love you for sure.
Lying on your bed staring up at the moon. You got me crazy, gotta love you soon. I'm your backdoor lover. Coming from behind, oh yeah.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Breaking Mayberry, the show that understands that the greatest commodity of all is human life. I'm one of your hosts. I'm Marty Schneider.
I'm your other host, Dan Ludwig, who is using his chi to hold the mic right now. That's right. No microphone arm required. I'm just gently touching it and not grasping it in any way, making me the chosen one of cops, I guess? I'm like the Neo of 70s police. Wow, I'm really jumping ahead.
That's okay. That's okay, Dan, because now that we've introduced the episode and we've done the first 30 seconds, bye.
Yep.
Bye, everyone. We're done. Marty and Dan out. Enjoy, let's say, Clint and Grant.
Yeah, seem like they can handle this. We'll be doing the rest of this. They're doing their own podcast. We're just kind of here to introduce it. Let you know it's whatever it is, it's probably a good idea. We have no fucking we have no clue, but you know, we get paid either way. So we'll circle back at the end to tell you guys that we did a good job. So peace.
Later. I should just put in a different podcast right here. I should just do a clip from a different show.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. No, Dan and I are still here, so we're gonna make that joke make sense. We're doing Backdoor Lovers, and we're not doing an intro. We're just going straight into this shit because there's so much to talk about with
the
this.
Backdoor Lovers are going straight in, unlubricated.
Backdoor, going right in the back door, just going right up there.
Yeah. Hard and fast.
Backdoor Lovers is our mini-series about failed backdoor pilots for spinoffs of TV shows. And today's is the worst one we've ever done.
Yes.
On multiple levels. It's the worst episode of TV. It's the worst at creating a pilot that I want to watch. It's the worst at connecting to the origin that you're spinning off from.
It is every backdoor pilot we've done has been sort of a unique snowflake of how much of it is an episode of the original TV show. Some of them are a lot, almost entirely an episode of the original TV show. Some of them are barely the cast of the main TV show just kind of briskly walk through the show and tell everybody that they're doing a great job. And this is the one where it is the most abrupt and clear where it stops being chips and it starts being 4-7. You yep. can isolate it down to the second.
Yeah. Dan revealed it. We are doing an episode of Chips. This is a spinoff from or a failed attempt to do Chips. And one thing I've noticed about this, Dan, is the timing in which somebody does or the timing in which a show does one of these.
Yeah.
Because it seems like it's either done at the second season where Dukes of Hazzard style, where it's like, we've got a big hit. We need to cash in on this hit and create more of this hit. Or it's done in this case in the last season, or in this case, the last episode of the second to last season. Maybe somebody's left the show. There's been a casting change. That's what happened with Charmed. We're running out of gas.
Yeah. Like,
this show's getting off the off ramp and we need to see what's happening next. Such is the case with this episode of Chips, in which the fate of the show, this is the last episode of the fifth season, and the fate of the show is kind of leaning in the balance. Its big star, Eric Estrada, left for several episodes during this season while his contract was being renegotiated. The other star is not coming back next season, so it is gone. It is gone. So this is the last episode of Chips, of the season of Chips. It is season 5, episode 27, entitled Force 7, originally airs May 23rd, 1982. And if you've never seen Chips before, if you don't know what Chips is, it doesn't matter. It does not matter. I can't stress to you how much it doesn't matter, because this is categorically not an episode of Chips.
It is a webisode of Chips, and then an entire different show. It is a commercial for Chips, and then a different show. Let's just do the Chips part, because then I want to talk about Chips. A show know absolutely nothing about.
I know very little about Chips as well, but the part of Chips where we get to our friends Paunch and John, who are CHP motorcycle cops, we see them for the first couple of minutes right before the opening credits. They are highway patrol officers. Uh-huh. They pull a man over for reckless driving using, and the Chips Wikipedia told me this, the let's call it the ultra high speed Chips wiki.
The ultra feathered Chips wiki, the ultra coiffed Chips,
the ultra
wiki,
the ultra permed
in the breeze.
Yeah. I like that Chips wiki. The Chips wiki, whoever writes for the Chips wiki, by the way, is actually funny. I gotta say, they got a sense of humor about this. They hate this shit. They fucking hate 4-7 and will not like have no bones about it. So our buddies Paunch and John, the motorcycle cop, pull over a guy for speeding and reckless driving. And this is how fucking lazy they are with this. According to the Chips wiki, they reused footage from a car chase scene in an earlier episode here. So it's not even an original car chase. The 2 minutes of things. They pull a guy over. He's some sort of scientist.
He is driving, like, swerving wildly, speeding. They pull him over. And as they are pulling him over, he says, this is the last thing I need. Cops. Like, yells at them, like, you're the last thing I need. Cops. I'm an important engineer with places to be. And then they arrest him. And in the process of him being arrested, he just drops a manila folder on the ground containing missile secrets.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a file that says confidential all over it, and John picks it up and is like, hey, do you remember when that, like, nuclear warhead got hijacked, that the truck carrying that missile got hijacked a few weeks ago? This has some schematics for it. This guy's got top secret schematics that I'm looking at that just fell out of his fucking car. They were, like, on his floorboard, where I put old soda cans. Like,
yeah. Was it in the cup holder? Was it, like, next to a Wendy's, a Wendy's cup? What the fuck? Where did he have this?
So John picks it up, looks at it, and then Paunch immediately, as if to give setup, goes, huh, we better let someone else take care of this.
The specific thing that Paunch says is, let's send this up the chain. See if this guy is righteous or if he's dangerous. What the fuck do you mean by that, Paunch? That is an insane thing to say. What could that possibly mean?
What kind of righteous brother is carrying top secret, like, warhead plans just in his fucking Ford LTD?
I'm going to throw out, Paunch, the drunk driver carrying schematics for a short-range missile. Not cool. Not a chill dude.
Not a chill guy. That guy cannot hang. All right. So we've done more talking about this than Paunch and John appear. And then they are gone. Forget about Chips. Forget about Paunch and John. It's Force 7 time, baby. What is Force 7? Force 7 is ninja cops. It's cops who are ninjas.
First note on Force 7. Why is it not called Ninja Cops? Why on earth is it not called Ninja Cops? It is the biggest layup decision in the history of television. You have cops that are ninjas. It is the 70s. Name it Ninja Cops. Why is it called 4-7? And I'm just going to jump ahead there. There's not even seven of them. There's not even seven. There's 4-5 if you're being very charitable and also racist. Like,
so... They don't explain it, but if you look in the background, If you look in the background of the first scene of Force 7, the name is explained because there is a sign that details the six stages of force that police use, starting with number one, verbal force, and number six, which is deadly weapon shooting firearm force. Mm. That's called that. So those are the six stages of force. What Force 7 claims is, what if there was another level of force, and that force was karate?
Mm-hmm.
And it also makes no fucking sense, because the entire purpose of Force 7, according to the people in Force 7, is to do non-lethal protecting. Like, they make a big deal of, we don't carry guns. Yes. Which in the hierarchy of most, or at least to most violent, would make them six.
Yes,
they would be six, and then guns would be the new seven.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. It is okay. They really have a lot of shit to say about this, and I'm trying to figure out what I want to say in what order. I think the first thing I'm going to say is, in terms of the stated morality of Force 7, I am shocked by how on board I am. I am like, you know what, Force 7? This is like you contacted 12-year-old me and said, Dan, young Dan, put down the Yu-Gi-Oh cards. How would you solve the issue with police shootings? And then I would be like, I'm glad you asked. I have this locked and loaded and ready to go. Have you tried teaching the cops kung fu? Have you tried that? And then they were like, we're not going to, but we are going to make a show about it.
That is the idea behind Force 7. The idea behind Force 7 is, we could lessen police brutality by taking away guns and giving the cops nunchucks.
Which... not wrong.
It lowers fatalities. It sure. Would
lower fatalities. It demonstrates.
Cops already have sticks. Like, cops have already sticks. Have sticks and batons that they hit people with all the fucking time.
Yes, yes. Again, it's not solving the cops hitting people problem. It is ideally solving the cops shooting people problem. So you're really just kind of. You're just transferring it from one bucket to another bucket.
Force 7 basically works off of Batman logic, where yes. It's like, it's, I don't shoot them, I don't kill them, it's fine. I just kick that man so hard that, like, two of his spinal vertebrae are definitely shattered. But that's not killing him, so it's super better.
He has severe neurological damage and will lose vision in his right eye. And basically we'll have CTE later on, but he's fine, okay? Yeah, he shouldn't have been robbing that bank. He's not dead.
My morals are totally, totally complete. No challenges here.
His family now has to take care of a man who is wheelchair bound and who is going to have dementia by the age of 65, but that's their problem. I'm Batman.
That's the 4-7 like logic. So we're getting deep into this. So, a guy named Rick Nichols,
Rick sucks such shit.
Played by Tom Riley, is our new sexy, like, hot shot. He's the new guy. He's an arrogant, like, tough guy cop who got in some trouble with the sergeant. And we see him pulling into a abandoned high school. And he's wandering around the abandoned high school when we're gonna have to go scene by scene for this, because yeah. It makes no fucking sense otherwise. It doesn't make any sense when we do it. And he is greeted by a man in a karate gi and an eye patch, who is yes. he is Nick Fury. This is Nick Fury and Iron Fist. Just that's who these two dudes are. So he meets Lieutenant John Laguerre, who is the leader of a new group called Force 7, which makes Rick Nichols go, I don't know what Force 7, never heard of a Force 7. Fred Laguerre is, John Laguerre is played by a man named Fred Dreyer.
Fred fucking Dreyer, which it took me a sec to place him. He was in a show called Hunter that actually sounds like some pretty sick dog shit, about a Dirty Harry style cop who's the son of a mobster. But he was also, like, apparently a pretty great football player back in the day.
He was a linebacker for the LA Rams, retired with over 100 sacks.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and this dude like has a good build for an action star and for a football player.
But
whatever.
Very, very much not for a kung fu guy, which is what everybody is. Like, this is very much a show about white people being able to do martial arts.
Right.
It is.
And one magic Asian woman.
Yes. One magic Asian woman that is kind of, it just feels like she's there to go like, this isn't 100% whitewashing. This isn't complete appropriation. See, I'm here.
With my Oriental mysticism, I make it better. Yes.
Yeah. This came out at the height of like a period where white people had seen martial art movies and were like, gimme,
horny for the ninja.
Yeah. We were like, I have seen your Bruce Lee movies and I want, please. I would like to be the martial arts man. Can you do a Bruce Lee movie? But instead of me seeing a person that doesn't look like me, a white man, can you make it like look like me? And then Hollywood was like, boy, can we. Do we have 400 movies for you? And then the question is like, well, in any of them, the white man that does martial arts, will he know how to do martial arts? And Hollywood was just like, oh, shit, was that important? Was that a factor for? Oh, no, sorry, no. Almost entirely across the board, no. We got like a guy. We have one white guy that can do that. And he's in pretty high demand. Do you want somebody that can, like, we showed him the hand motions. Does that work? And that was like Hollywood for 15 years,
basically. A good chunk of time. Yes.
Yeah. So
kind of still is, but now they can just like do laser and swirly things around the white guy. So mm-hmm. it matters even less, right?
Yes.
That he knows what he's doing. For sure. For sure. So that's it. We're introduced to Force 7, which is two cops with something to prove, right? Rick is there because he got in trouble with some sergeant, and this is his last chance. John Laguerre is there because he's trying to prove that there's a better way to do cops. And then he takes us to the school gymnasium, where we're introduced to the other 2.5 members of Force 7.
Okay, I think what we should do is let's divide and conquer on describing the other two members of Force 7. Okay. Which of them do you want, Marty? which one do you want the job of describing?
I'll take Cindy. Okay. Cindy is the aforementioned mystical Asian woman. Her backstory is she's a cop. Her husband was also a cop. He was killed in the line of duty. And she's in Force 7 because that's what makes her feel okay about being a cop. She's the only one who has anything close to a character arc here. That is the only, but also her role is to be an Asian lady and just kind of like nod affirmatively. Like, I'm fine with everything that's happening here, including the thing that Dan is about to tell us about. I'm giving the A-okay on all of this. Also, as the woman, it's my job to go like, you're out of line and costing us. You're having too much fun.
Yeah.
So just keep that in mind. Cindy's there just nodding and giving an okay and a thumbs up to everything that is in Force 7. She's all behind Force 7. Daniel?
Tony Longo plays the busiest character ever, Sly Angeletti, who is a big, gangly Italian guy.
Poor man
Stallone. Great description. Who knows martial arts, which you would think would probably be the most important thing about him. But no, the most important thing about him is that he is a ventriloquist, apparently. What kind of puppet would a white martial artist ventriloquist use? You guessed it, the most racist fucking thing I've ever seen in my fucking life. Just the purest distillation of human racism into a like a shard, a crystal. Just this ultimate puppet. It is what the I won't even I can't even remember his, the puppet's fucking name. And
no,
I can't
no,
even
I'll tell guess. You what the puppet's name was. It is Sir Yin of Yang.
Yes.
Sir Yin of Yang. And he does have like the Fu Manchu outfit. It's in a way, as far as ventriloquism goes, it's impressive to both throw your voice and do a racist accent.
Except I can see they have him do it, and I can see he has to grit his teeth, and I can see his vocal cords straining. He's a shit ventriloquist on top of it.
He can't say his P's and he can't say his L's.
Like, yeah.
He's doing the worst. He's doing the fucking worst thing I've ever. Oh, it's awful.
Okay, so I don't. I've already forgotten his name. I feel like my brain is actively purging it every time I hear it.
His
so,
name is, oh my, remember how I just said that he's a poor man Stallone? His character's name is literally Sly.
No, the character's name, it's the fucking puppet's name, Marty, that I
Yin, refuse. Yin Yang. Yin.
We're going to call him
Yin. We're going to call him Yin.
They position Yin. So Yin pops in and he's like, oh, you guys are doing karate. That's funny.
I like how we're referring to Yin as if he is a character.
Yeah, this happens. Well, the show
He might as well be. Like, the lines that Sly has are about 50-50 him delivering lines as himself and him delivering lines in the racist puppet voice.
Hey, Marty, Yin introduces himself as the fifth member of the 4-7.
That's true.
He is like, oh, hello, I am. I'm kind of the Slimer of this show. I'm a major reoccurring character. Mr. Yin, not going anywhere, and I'm going to be on the t-shirt. You better believe I am going to be on the t-shirts that they sell. We're introduced to Mr. Yin. We're introduced to the 4-7. At one point, basically, Fred Dreyer just goes like, all right, listen, we don't have the full 4-7 right now. We don't have the funding for all the 7. We're kind of hedging our bets. We don't want to get locked into too many people this quickly. Once we get picked up, we'll pick the other two guys, okay?
He's almost like looking into the camera just being like, you know, if only we had 22 more adventures to flesh this out.
He literally, at one point he says, this is our home base until we get funding. So it was basically like, please don't let the fact that we're in a high school gymnasium reflect upon the show. We're going to have a super sick ass headquarters once we get picked up. But this is the place we first see the martial arts that this show is bringing to the table. We only get to see a little bit of it. It's just people hitting each other with sticks. It's just people hitting each other with sticks.
Yeah.
It's just a lady has two sticks and a guy has two sticks. And they're hitting each other with the coordination and skill of me and my best friend Tim Lane when we were 10 and we had two sticks. It's that. It is what me and Tim did.
We first get this. We get the I know Kung Fu, show me the Neo versus Morpheus fight between our arrogant hotshot Rick Nichols, who says, I've been doing karate since I was 7 years old and I'm the greatest there is, and karate's the best there is. Our one-eyed sensei John Laguerre says something like, what does he say? Karate cannot always defang the snake.
Yeah.
That's what these people fucking talk like. That's how they fucking talk. And then to which Rick says, I haven't met a snake yet that can beat it. Ha ha! And they have their fight, and Rick is bested. All right, so then we move on, because all of a sudden 4-7 is notified of the missing warhead. They get word from the mayor of Los Angeles.
Yes, who is like, this is exactly why I put the 4-7 together. Which is, that's why you put them together? No, it's supposed to be a thing for killing less people. And it's like, the SEAL Team 6 of the Los Angeles Police Department.
Why is the mayor of Los Angeles in charge of response to this at all?
Yeah.
A military grade missile has gone missing.
It's not
that is
nuclear.
Above the okay, but it's still a missile. It's still a
yes.
Yeah, that is above the mayor of Los Angeles' pay grade.
This is at least a state matter, I would say. This is probably the governor's call.
When Ponch said, let's run this up the chain to someone higher, he meant higher than this.
Yes.
He meant way higher. Ponch is just in the background screaming, no, no, keep going. Keep further.
Much further. Like James Bond further. Like, get the actual Nick Fury, not the dime store karate one. Yeah, so, but immediately, the point of this is confused, because at first they're just like, we are an alternative to the SWAT team that kills less people. That's our whole thing. And then the mayor is like, you guys are the Thunderbirds? You're the ultimate crime-fighting edge. It just gets confused very quickly. But also, they say they got the tip for it because of the two traffic patrolmen who picked up the drunk driver, who was then released.
Yes, yes.
The big problem is that they caught him, found that he had missile schematics, and then let him go. They're like, yeah, they let him go before anybody who knew stuff could get their hands on him. To which I would say, no. We saw that in the first fucking scene. Ponch looked at him and was like, this man is very dangerous and should not be released from custody. Also, we have him on drunk driving.
Yeah, they had him at least on a DUI, right? Yeah. They could have held him there in the tank for like 48 hours anyway. Like, what's great about this is not only are these guys not Ponch and John, not only are they not friends with Ponch and John, they don't know Ponch and John, but the official statement of the 4/7 TV show is Ponch and John are fuck-ups who are bad at their jobs. Like, eat shit, Ponch and John.
In a perfect world, there would be no chips. The thesis statement of 4/7 is that we need less Ponch and Johns in the world.
That's right. Last time we did Charmed, I was like, Charmed doesn't give a shit if they get a spinoff. This time the spinoff is actively antagonistic to the concept. And let's go ahead and pause here, because I've been thinking about this for a while. Imagine if you were a fan of Chips, right? Mm-hmm. Imagine if Chips was your favorite show, and here you are tuning in to the last episode of the season.
Yeah. Right?
It's Wednesday at 9 or whatever. It's time for Chips. I'm going to see my guys.
If Ponch is going to get a hand job on his motorcycle or whatever the fuck happens in this show.
You got this? You get this instead? I would be so pissed.
Yes.
Mad.
Imagine if you were a diehard Chips fan, which was a thing back then, and they did not have a lot of options. You kind of took what you got. Imagine if you were a huge fan of Eric Estrada.
Right, and this is the last episode of season 5. By season 4, most people were like, "All right, Chips is pretty much done." They were like, but they're still fans. People are still watching the show, right? But not only are you watching this, I'm gonna be so mad, but this is so far away from my understanding of what Chips is. It's not even like this is a show like Chips. No, this is so opposite of what, because Chips was it was like a comedy serious police show in the vein of like Castle, about like fighting against drug smugglers and street racers and like gang violence, stuff that the fucking highway patrol would do. 4/7 comes in and is basically like, that shit sucks. That all sucks and is boring, and we should be doing cool ninja shit instead.
4/7 declares sovereign citizen midway through. We at 4/7 no longer recognize the laws and rights of Chips over us. We are our own show now. We have branched off. and we are declaring hostilities against Chips. Okay, but wait, so you've never watched Chips, right?
I watched the Chips movie with Dax Shepard and Michael Pena, and I
oh
thought
God.
I thought it was decent. I thought okay. it was okay. But I know what Chips is. I've seen like Chips in the periphery.
I mean, but okay, so I'm going off of the opening scene and also the credits, which is just two cops on motorcycles who are driving way too close together on the highway. Get out of, don't be in the same lane right next to each other. That's dangerous. What if one of you has to swerve out of the way of a pothole? But what could it possibly be about? Because they're not like detectives or anything. They're highway patrolmen. They pull people over. How often do they find like cocaine in somebody's car and then have to, like, how do they justify being like, are there a lot of highway murders but that are in motion the whole time so they can't leave the motorcycles?
Yeah, you know how at the beginning of this episode says, let's run this up the chain to someone important? That should be every episode.
Yes!
That's his job.
That is, yes, that is the basically the premise of True Detective Season 2, is a highway patrolman finds a murder and goes, well, on to police. There you go. I can't even arrest people. I have a motorcycle. What am I going? When did they? You know what else they had to roll up the chain? Taking this drunk away, because they don't have a car, Marty. They can't. They had to call somebody else to come arrest the drunk man. Is that why he was in the wind? They were like, "All right, well, we got you dead to rights for drunk driving and weapons dealing." But we only got these motorcycles, so get out of here. I want to see you again.
I was wondering about this myself, because also, like I said, this is the last episode of the season. You know the season finale? The thing where the part where shit normally happens?
Yeah.
Like people get shot or whatever? Not only is this the season finale, this is the last episode of Larry Wilcox, the guy who plays John. So this is the last time you're going to see one of the main characters ever. So I was like, okay, well, what happened right before this? Maybe like the real season finale happened before this. So I'm going to read you the description of season 5, episode 26. Ponch and John work with police sniffer dogs on the LA Sheriff's Department on the trail of bombs, drugs, and thieves. And the way they describe it is in Amazon Prime or Freevee is something like, Ponch and John learn to respect canine cops as the police officers that they are. So it's just dogs. The last episode was just dogs. The episode behind that, before that, is computer thieves jam the CHP computer center and attempt to rendezvous with an ocean-bound yacht. So I think what happened a lot on Chips was two guys wildly overstepping their jurisdiction.
I think
and
it's
car it's, crashes.
What if like the previous episode was just Ponch and John, and they're just like, you know what I really hate, Ponch? What's that, John? White men doing karate. I think it's unethical and has no place on the police force. And Ponch is like, absolutely, I agree. But I think Chips is basically just blistering, full-throated copaganda, but is also like, but also it's boring. Let's do some fun shit.
I think Chips is literally a response to Dukes of Hazzard. NBC wanted their own like excuse to crash a bunch of cars, and they were like, okay, but what if it was the good guys, not the outlaws? What if cops were good this time? So that's what Chips was.
Yeah.
Why are we talking about Chips, my dude? This isn't Chips.
We had to untangle the mystery of Chips.
This ain't Chips XXX. Like a porn parody of Chips has more Chips in common.
I think Chips is the porn parody of Chips. But
Clits? Yeah. Mm.
I'm not.
A chips play with me in the space. A Chips porn parody has more in common with Chips than this episode of Chips does, is the point I'm fucking getting at.
Back to 4-7.
So, 4-7 also is its own porn parody name.
Yes.
Fair enough. All right. Yeah. So 4-7, back to this shit. They found out, let's see if I can recap the plot of 4-7. There are 16 military parts that are required to build the thing to launch the missile.
Yes.
And somehow the military has sold all 16 of these at auction, never imagining that anyone could buy all 16 at once or like there would be a secondary market. So their move is to go investigate a warehouse where all of these things are moving through. To find the buyers.
To find the one warehouse that bought all of these components. You know how when the government accidentally does an Infinity Gems.
Right.
Yeah, they did it. Oops, they did an Infinity Gems. They sold 16 things that make a death. They have to go to the one warehouse that bought all this shit. Something that only they can only do through the power of karate. Only you need the power of karate to be able to look at warehouse shipments.
At this point, right? I told you in advance what was going on, but I was watching this going, okay, this is where they meet Ponch and John, right?
Yeah.
Ponch and John are going to get him into the warehouse, right? No? Okay. It wasn't until the second time, they break into the same warehouse twice, and it wasn't until the second time, which is about the 30-minute mark, where I go, oh, Ponch and John are not coming back. So I have to imagine if I was watching this on NBC in 1983, my face would just keep getting lower and lower and lower as I keep waiting for my buddies to return.
And
they're not coming.
Ponch and John.
They're not coming. They are not coming back.
I'm a season 5 Chips viewer. Ponch and John are all I got, dude. I'm on by a thread. If I don't get my daily dose of Estrada, I'm blowing them out, dude. I like my brains are going on the wall.
1982 is not going well for you, man.
No. Season 5 Chips viewer. God, he is in a perpetual state of just got fired.
All right, so yeah, this fucking guy.
So they go to the warehouse, and the strategy is that
Laguerre and Sly are going to distract the team distract the warehouse workers by
the goons
by showing off their strength and how good they are at lifting boxes. They put on just a pretty big show of look what I can do for a job.
Their thing is we are here for jobs unloading boxes because we are so strong. And then they pick up boxes that are clearly empty,
very clearly easily,
and put them down. And the guys are like, all right, we'll hire you. And then they haggle about money. And then meanwhile, the other two, Cindy and main character, break into the warehouse disguised as ninjas. Not disguised, dressed as ninjas. They're ninjas.
I can't tell you enough. They wear these ninja outfits. You know, the typical ninja, like, black pajamas all the time in broad daylight in the middle of a field.
Yes.
Like, this isn't helping. People can see you. Everyone can see you. You're wearing the ninja Halloween costumes.
Like, it is so Halloween costume. It is 110% child's Halloween costume.
So they break in. They're trying to find some information. I had to watch this scene a couple of times to figure out what exactly Rick fucks up.
Yeah.
He makes some noise and they almost get caught and they sneak out a window.
He knocks over a ladder with his foot. I watched it multiple times to try to figure out what else he did. I was because they were like, you're cocky. You're hot dogging. You think you're hot shit. The next scene
is Cindy yelling at him like, we had a job to do and you almost got us caught. And I had to rewind and go, what?
He knocked over a ladder. I mean, should he have done that? No. He's pretty bad ninja-ing.
I gotta say, one of the key things of ninjas is that they are quiet.
Yeah. I based off of the way she was yelling at him, I was like, did I miss a part where he goes, hey, want to see me jump over this small ladder? Like, I thought he was, also, I have to emphasize, not big ladder, little foot ladder. I was like, did he go like, hey, you want to see me do a kick-ass flip? But no, he just is walking and a ladder falls over.
Can I also go ahead and say, eventually they come back to this warehouse. Rick and John have a big fight with the warehouse workers. And I guess the warehouse workers are goons. They are on the bad guy's payroll. But I really imagine, like this is 16 items, right? There's other shit in that warehouse. Those guys are just working for a shipping company.
They
and then some ninjas came and beat the shit out of some fucking Teamsters.
They could not read less as henchmen. Why didn't you make them more of henchmen? They're not like, oh yeah, this is Knuckles and Tony the Teeth. It's like, oh yeah, this is Bill. He has sciatica. This is Tony.
His guys doing their jobs doing
well in school. Yeah, it's guys that are going to hard times.
One of them kind of looks like a chubby Robert Redford. So these are just guys with jobs. Like, these are just guys in the union, and two other dudes show up to be like, hey, we'll be scabs. Can we be scabs? Look how high we can reach the box. And then one guy goes, all right, well, you can scab. I'll pay you a scab wage. And then they go, we'll think about it and leave. What a weird fucking day at work. What a weird fucking day. Go home to your wife, Charlene, who is a hairdresser, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you're in your apartment, and you're like, Charlene, weirdest fucking thing happened today.
Some dudes came in and they did feats of strength. You know, you ever see that? You ever see some guys do feats of strength for you? They did that, and then they just walked away.
And then later on, I heard something, and a ladder had been knocked over. That was it. That was my day. How was your day at the salon, honey?
I don't know how much more of this I can do, Charlene. I'm nearing the end of my rope.
So they go back. Then they go back after we get some character moments, some shit you don't care about. Cindy gets her monologue about her being a cop's widow. Her dead husband, right? John and Rick get into it about like, oh, no one ever helped me with anything. Well, now you're part of a team, blah, blah, blah. Fortunately, we're spared a racist puppet monologue. That guy kind of just disappears for a little while.
Yeah.
And then they go back to the warehouse. This time they do, the ninjas get caught sucking shit at ninja, just terrible at this ninja job. They get into a fight with the warehouse workers who, again, I think at this point are just like, hey, man, this is our job. Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, so they catch Rick. Rick does ninja pose. Bad ninja pose.
They chase Rick down an aisle, and Rick's plan is to go another ladder, a big ladder this time, a ladder that goes to nowhere. Like one of the big shelf, like ladders you push back and forth to get to something on a higher shelf. So they corner him as he's like halfway climbing a rolling ladder. And then
the guys are not like, ha, we're going to kill you, you son of a bitch. We're henchmen. They're like, hey, come on, buddy. I don't know why you dress like no ninja, and I don't know why you're doing no goofy pose, but we're gonna have to hurt you. What are you doing? And then they just get the fuck beaten out of them. Because the other guy shows up, Fred Dreyer shows up, and they just hit them with sticks a whole bunch. Like, again, not reading as henchmen. And this is, I feel like this is the first part where we really get some martial arts, which is absolutely fucking baffling to watch, because there is no correspondence between the thing a man does and the thing that happens to the other man that he is doing it to,
like, or the noise that is made. Like, no, somebody is standing off to the side with a soundboard that is just like ninja noise, like bah. And he's just hitting the soundboard pads randomly because the punch sounds do not match the hitting of the actual motion of the punch. Like somebody is just here makes the like hitting noise while they are falling backwards. None of it makes any sense.
It's like me and Marty were fighting and I did something that kind of looked like punching Marty in the face and he just started grabbing his shin and jumping up and down. It's all like that. Like it's just complete chaos, and there's so many shots of supposed hits that are so clearly not touching the man, but he's just like ah. Like there is no ability to film an action scene anywhere in this, which is crazy because I'm pretty sure Chips is kind of an action show. Like,
well, this was directed by a guy who had never directed an episode of Chips.
Yeah.
So, like, it's, again, this isn't Chips. Anyway, they beat up the employees, but then we hear a big booming voice. It's the bad guy. He's here. And I wish that we had commercials on this show, because here would be an excellent time for a commercial break. Because coming down the stairs is John Rhys Davies. John Rhys Davies fucking appears. And I looked this up. This is after Raiders. So, like, at this point, if you're sticking around for this episode of Chips in 1983, you're going, Sala?
All right, did you go Sala or did you go Gimli when this happened?
That's a good question. The question is, like, who do you associate John Rhys Davies with? I associate John Rhys Davies with Sala.
See, third option, I immediately went, Professor from Sliders?
Oh, yeah.
That, and then I had to realize, like, oh yeah, that's two much more important people. So,
so John Rhys Davies appears, and then he is a bad guy named some kind of other like ninja warrior named Nakura, who knows Laguerre from
so clearly Asian in the script, and then they got their hands on John Rhys Davies and did not do a single fucking rewrite.
No,
like yeah. His name is Nakura, and he is like, it's been a long time since Saigon, the last time we saw each other. What does he call fucking, Fred Dreyer?
Laguerre, right?
He calls him Laguerre in that, like, John Rhys Davies voice, like, Laguerre. It's the best part of the fucking episode.
I mean, it might as well be Laguerre-san, right?
Yeah.
And then, so he and Laguerre hold hands for a couple of minutes?
They do, like, the thing where they just basically, like, do their kung fu poses at each other. And then Nakura is just like, yeah, I'd win. And Laguerre is like, fuck! And then allows himself to be tied up.
And then he's captured.
And yeah, and then they're just captured. And it's like, I think it's just basically like he psychs out Fred Dreyer so bad that Fred Dreyer is like, I gotta surrender. He'll whoop my ass into next week if I fuck with him right now.
There's so much fucking shit in this episode. So Nakura is the guy who built all of, who bought and is building the missile launcher. The Force 7 guys escape. I'm not even going to get into it.
They are about to be... I'm going to get into it. They're about to be killed with a knife. Fred Dreyer holds up his rope bonds, gets cut with the knife, takes the knife away, somehow manages to destroy a light bulb, so the two guys with Uzis are unable to see them, and they're like, I can't see anything. My gun has been rendered useless. And to which Fred Dreyer goes like, well, I have a knife. And they go like, let's get out of here. And run away. So, and at one point, Fred Dreyer takes like a little razor blade off the front of his belt and throws it at something. So the guy from the warehouse is coming back to Charlene with a much more interesting story today. Like, hey, honey, how was today at work? I'm not gonna lie, Charlene, it was significantly worse. I did not know how well we had it with the feats of strength and the knocked over ladder.
Oh,
a baritone man came in. I was kicked in the chest. A man hit me with metal bars, Charlene, very hard.
They broke one of those fluorescent bulbs. You ever see one of the fluorescent bulbs break? It goes everywhere. They're very expensive to replace.
I had to clean it up after. And meanwhile, my shoulder's killing me.
It's not coming out of my salary, I'll tell you what. I'll take it straight to the union.
You know who didn't clean it up? The French giant. He just left. He came in. He said some stuff. He left. I'm the one. I've already been hit by a metal bar. All right? And then he leaves. And then this guy kicks me in the head a bunch of times, Charlene.
You said the French giant. And I know you're talking about John Rhys Davies, but immediately I went to Andre the Giant. Like
this baritone martial artist, I suppose.
It's been a long time since I got a guy. It's me, a very Asian, extremely Asian ninja man, Andre the Giant.
About equal claim to being an Asian man to John Rhys Davies. So yeah, Charlene, I don't think the union's covering any of this.
So they escape. Nakora is like, whatever, no big deal. I'm going to hold the city of Los Angeles hostage. He sends a videotape to the mayor of Los Angeles. And again, I gotta be honest, like, you have a missile. Like, you can go higher than the mayor of LA. You can go up the ladder a little bit. But he sends a tape to the mayor saying that basically wire me a whole shitload of money or I'm going to launch this. 4-7 gets a hold of the tape and they find out where Nakora is.
Sorry. You skipped over a crucial part, which is the mayor gets the fucking message and he's like, all right, so what we're going to do is the normal thing, which is we're going to... So 4-7 figures out where he is based off of mapping constellations.
Right.
A thing that the police force, again, can't do because they do not have the power of karate. They tell the mayor, and the mayor is like, all right, cool. I'm going to send in, like, cops to get this guy. And Fred Dreyer goes like, right, with their machine guns and their explosions. And then in the chaos, Laguerre is going to fire his missile. And the mayor is like, damn it, you're right. This is exactly the situation I formed the 4-7 for. Which, like, I'm like at home like, no! No! No, this is not! They were created to reduce police violence. A noble cause! But I really cannot emphasize enough. Play this one by the book, please.
You'll send the SWAT team in there, and then Laguerre will go and launch the missile. Damn, dude, if only there was, like, a division or, like, a militia or, like, a group of things or something whose whole job it is to fucking blow up missiles in the air.
Like, yeah.
What if only we had like a whole like force of people who were armed for that, like some sort of armed forces.
Yeah.
Like, shit, dude. No, we need four ninjas and a racist puppet.
It's even like it's just like, you know, their exact location and you know that they have a missile and there is no world in which the United States government would just go like, boosh on that situation. Like, they would just move bombing the whole situation. Like, right. Yeah.
They figure out where he is, so, and they convince the mayor. The mayor's like, okay, I guess you're right. I won't send in a SWAT team.
Again, you have higher resources, but sure. I will send in just the 4-7. No, like, backup to the 4-7. Just them.
There's not even like any reason given why this has to be done silently, right? He doesn't ever say like, we can't have the whole city in panic, or like their headquarters is right in the middle of Bel Air. Like, who will talk? Like, there's no reason given why this has to be done silent by ninjas.
Yes. They break into the facility using a variety of stealthy techniques. My favorite of which is
Hang on. Let's break this down. the same way that we broke down the introductions. I will take Cindy's part.
Damn it. Okay. I wanted the Cindy's part. You go first.
Okay. So Cindy's role in this is to distract the guard dogs.
Yeah.
Which she does with her oriental mysticism by playing the flute, by playing notes on the flute that everyone can hear.
The guys are like, is that a fucking flute?
Everyone, like, I think the idea is supposed to be that she's playing at a high-pitched noise and it's like a dog whistle, and it's what's bringing the one guard dog, by the way. You got the missile, you've got this whole crew, this whole operation, you have one guard dog, one Rottweiler, yeah. That's all we brought. So she plays the wooden flute, right, because she's an Asian woman, so she's playing an Asian flute, of course she is, mm-hmm. right? And it's played at such a high frequency that the dogs come running to her and it attracts the dog to her. Except again, I can hear it. I can hear it. And she gives, and when the dog arrives, she blows Molly in the dog's face. She takes a little powder and goes, phew, and blows drugs in the dog's face. And now this dog is just happy and I think horny and tries to like knock over his owner and just play, but also hump. It's
you know, that powder you can spray in a dog's face that makes him have the zoomies. She sprays zoomies powder in his face. Molly is as good of a guess as any. Because, yeah, it just turns him into a normal dog. Like, that will not behave. I thought it was going to be like they would show the dog falling asleep. But, like, it doesn't even, like, take out one of the guards. The guard is just like, hey, quit it. Knock it off. Hey, come on.
He takes out one of the guards the way that, like, your dog would take you out. Like, hey. Come on, it's time to play, bro. And they kind of like knocked you over. So, yeah. I mean, the rest of the episode should be the two guards going, who's your good boy? Who's your good boy? And just like throwing sticks for this thing.
Yeah. Right? It would be so great if at some point they cut away and like they're just rubbing the dog's belly and they're like, do you have gunfire?
and one guard turns to the other and is like, man. Chester here really liked that flute music that we all completely heard. And speaking of things that aren't dog whistles, Dan?
Okay. So, Sly, ventriloquist, big man, he sees that there are two guards, and he sees that there's a tree, and he has an idea. And the idea is to put Mr. Ying, our favorite racist puppet, into the tree, and then do ventriloquism at it, and then the guards are like, what? A puppet in a tree? And I think, and the puppet says some stuff that's racist, and then he just jumps out and just like pushes them onto the ground, and then they're unconscious.
He specifically makes the puppet say something like, this is weird, isn't it, seeing a puppet in a tree? Well, it's what's called a distraction. Look behind you, dum-dum.
Yeah.
And then when the guys look behind them, and it takes a good second for Sly to jump out with a stick.
Which, very clearly, the effort to put a puppet in a tree, he was already behind them. He could have just hit them with the fucking stick.
You know what he else could have done? Just thrown his voice.
Yes.
You don't need the puppet. You could just be like, hey, over here, asshole. And then...
Maybe he had to do it so that they would also be distracted by like how poor of taste this is.
Right.
They'd be like, oh man, even for 1981, this is really poor form.
Charlene, I don't even want to tell you about it. Charlene is Korean, by the way.
Yes.
Yeah. So
Charlene, this would break your fucking heart.
Charlene, I don't want you. It would make your parents real sad. I don't want to even talk about it. Right.
This transfer did not pan out, Charlene. You just see things at this job.
I'm sorry to tell you about this, honey.
So Mr. Yin really has a little bit of a great gazoo energy going.
Here's what I want to know. Does he stuff Yin in his pocket? Because honestly, what would have been amazing is if he was just in the background fighting with fighting the stick, but he had the puppet on his hand. Right. I think he should have to fight with the puppet in his hand.
Yeah.
Where were they going with this character? What was 4-7 season 2 going to do with this?
Which, okay, just imagine they're on the way there and be like, all right, guys, we got to move. We got to stop this missile. Sly, why are you grabbing the puppet? There's not going to be a situation where the puppet is going to be useful. There might be. There's not. I promise you, there is not going to be a situation where you need a puppet. I swear to God.
22 like, episodes of them trying to find ways to use the puppet. This is it. This is the one this is the one function the puppet has. This, you've used it. You did it. This is the one time you can bring the puppet in.
Like, do you think, they would have had to uniquely, okay, there was going to be an instance at some point where somebody is having a crisis, like, what's the main character's name?
Rick
is like, I really don't know if I should keep doing police karate. I don't think it's for me. Maybe I should hang him up. Mr. Yin was 100% going to give him a speech about how he needs to believe in himself, right? Like, they were going to have Mr. Yin at some point be like, you know, I know a little something about adversity.
I'm thinking like a dream sequence or a drug sequence where Mr. Yin comes to life, played by George Takei, right? Or, you know, fuck it, it's the 80s Pat Morita.
Do you think they would get an Asian man to play Mr. Yin in the live action dream sequence? Do you think they would spend money on George Takei? Do you think for a second they would not hire a white man to play that character? Because they would.
Fair enough. It's Ted Danson.
God.
So then we have a big fight of finally a show. I forgot to mention this. As he's getting ready, John Rhys Davies goes into like a meditation mode, like to channel his anger or whatever. And there's an Obi-Wan Kenobi Darth Vader moment where Rhys Davies looks at the camera and he goes, I know you're coming, Laguerre. I can sense you. And Laguerre, who is using little like Wolverine claw spikes to climb up a wall, stops and go, oh no, as if he can hear John Rhys Davies. And then I can't, my favorite part of this whole thing, Rhys Davies, Nakura says, now the gloves are really off and it's time to have an ultimate showdown. And he puts on a luchador mask.
Yes.
That looks like underwear. It looks like such shit. He puts underwear on his head.
You think that you have seen some Halloween costume ass ninjas? You have not seen some bargain bin Halloween costume ninja outfit. Blue gi that looks like it is made out of tarp. It looks like it has been used to cover up a motorcycle in the garage. And silver bandana over the face, which magically transforms Jonathan Rhys Davies into a stuntman, like the power.
Right. Like, that's what really happens, is we are then treated to a very long chase and fight scene that is filmed very wide and far away from our character. Doesn't get too close to any of them.
Between two stuntmen, which is far and away the best part of the episode, hands down, is two people that know what the fuck they're doing a little bit, just working. Did you notice that when he's like, it is time for combat, Nakura picks up two swords, and then he is like walking to go fight Laguerre, and then they run into each other, and instead of two swords, Nakura is just with two butterfly knives.
Oh. You know what? Hang on a second. I think maybe they mentioned that in the mistakes and goofs section of the Chips Wiki. Let me go ahead and read what they have under mistakes. Making this episode.
Holy shit, really?
That's not a joke. That's what it says.
The Chips Wiki guy rules. I love this motherfucker.
Okay, so now we're at the final battle, and Laguerre wins. He pins John Rhys Davies Nakora against the warhead and says basically, like, I'm going to kill you if you don't give me the code. And John Rhys Davies says, that's against your morals. And Laguerre goes, what you gonna do, basically, right?
Yeah. Like,
isn't your whole thing not killing? Well, whatever. So he gives him the code. Dan, what's the code?
Justifiably, you are about to blow up Los Angeles. I'll make an exception.
Dan, what's the code?
The code is 666. Which, like, I almost expected Laguerre to just turn to him and go, like, really?
Are you fucking kidding really? Me, man?
Are you kidding me?
I feel like I could have guessed that. Like,
yeah.
Like, it wouldn't be the first thing I did, but if you gave me 5 tries, I would have gotten it in 4, right?
Really? Really, Nakora? I didn't know you were fucking 14. Are you kidding me? This is serious. I do a serious job. I don't need your shit.
I'm sorry. Is the backup 420? Like, what the fuck, dude?
Is this a joke to you, Nakora? I'm here. I'm putting it all out on the table.
Are you calling a fucking? Are you calling your fucking escape helicopter? Just going code 69, code 69. It's like, you fucking Elon Musk motherfucker.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Are you gonna pitch your metal band to me after this? Is that what's gonna happen?
So then they put in code 666, but then the detonator goes off for another 2 minutes anyway because there's a backup. Someone must have put in a backup code.
So it was the drunk driver that got killed by a guy with an axe in a scene we forgot about. The drunk driver shows back up and he's like...
The engineer guy, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he's like, I did my job and it's time for you to give me my money. And Nakora is like, yes, absolutely. Incidentally, have you met my friend, guy with an axe? And then the guy with an axe starts, like, swinging an axe near him as the engineer goes, like, I sure hope that axe has nothing to do with me. And then we don't see it, but he dies. So I think presumably he put, like, a dead man switch into the missile idea. In case somebody killed him with an axe.
Yeah, that was sort of the plan. You know what else we forgot? There's so many plot elements. We forgot to introduce that Rick has superpowers. The whole thing, our main character has telekinesis. We forgot that. We just forgot that fucking detail about the guy. That's why he's on the team, is that he can harvest his chi.
So the Fred Dreyer sly conversation specifically is like, so why do you let this fucking asshole onto our team anyway? And Fred Dreyer just goes like, his chi. He has great chi. And Sly just goes, I once saw an old Asian man lift up an entire barrel with just the palm of his hand. And Fred Dreyer's just like, yeah, he can maybe do shit like that. I don't know how I know that. I didn't see him do chi. I guess sense it in him.
Is like, it in his like police report? Is it in his dossier? Did he list it on his resume? Stats,
on his stats? Like, health, 75. Chi, 46. Weak against lightning.
like, what? It's the only time that this comes up. The only time this comes up is they pry open the warhead, and there's just, like, a detonator somewhere inside of it. So... Mm-hmm. And Laguerre's like, my fingers are too big. I can't reach in there. And then Sly's like, what if there was a puppet that had small hands? Someone needs someone with small hands. No, he doesn't do that.
I really thought that's what it was going to be. Like, what? Okay. So he's like, my hands are too big and meaty to get in there. And then he's like, Rick. Get in here. And I thought it was like, Rick, with your little bitch fingers, get in here. Rick,
I forgot about the chi because it never came up.
No! It was so fast that he mentioned the chi. So I thought he was just saying, only we had somebody on the team with little fingers, little baby hands. Rick!
Like a 5'2" Asian woman.
Only we had somebody like that on the team.
Well, by the way, Sydney's job at this point is just repeating the computer. She's back. She's just saying, we're down to 30 seconds. That's her only role.
Mm-hmm.
So
Rick uses his chi by just, he places his palm on the missile and he just pulls out the warhead. It's like a red, it looks like a ring.
The plunger?
Pop. Yeah.
The uranium? The blowy uppy part?
The chemical weapon part? It's really unclear. But he pulls it out with his palm, and then Nakura is just like, everybody get away from the bomb! And then they jump away, and it explodes, but it doesn't. I guess it's not a dirty bomb now.
Yeah, it's just a small explosion, and it doesn't go to the rest of the nuclear part, or the warhead part that is the biggie explosion, I guess.
They pull out the warhead. Nakura, I guess, just hangs out until he is presumably arrested.
Right. Because then they just kind of peace out. Like, there's like a line where Rick says, I don't know what to say. What can I tell you? And LeCaire goes, do us a favor and don't say anything, hotshot. And then they just leave?
Yeah.
I mean, if anything, right, they're worse than Ponch and John, who have the motorcycle, because they got nothing. Is there a ninja van waiting for them to put John Rhys Davies in? What?
Yeah.
Does he get away? Who knows? Final scene is that Ponch and John are walking with their boss down a hallway. Their boss says, hey, remember that douche you pulled over a couple of weeks ago? That's the line. That's not me exaggerating. That is what he says.
I checked the subtitles twice to make sure it. First, to make sure they said it, and the second time to make sure it wasn't a dubbing error.
No, he says, hey, remember that douche you pulled over? Well, he got into all sorts of crazy shit later. And they go, oh yeah, what's crazy about it? Oh, there was like a nuclear warhead and like ninjas and stuff. And Ponch goes, so when does the crazy part start? Because that's his joke, right?
Yeah.
And then they go, man, that stuff sure was weird. And Ponch is like, eh, just normal stuff, right? All crooks get arrested by the law. And then they just laugh together, and then they're
fucking
done. That's it. That's it. Hey, that's the end.
Marty, is this how you found out that you can say douche on daytime television? Because I was like, they've been able to say that the whole time? They can't say shit, but they can call somebody a douche?
Call them a douche.
I guess they say they have the douche jar on New Girl. So at least, but like, I cannot believe they never called Frank a douche on MASH.
Oh, I have to remember, by the way, Ponch and John get a commendation from the LAPD.
Yes! They're like, they get like a medal, right?
Their arrest, which by the way, for the guy they let go, but yes! they get a commendation for arresting the guy that led them to all of this stuff with the missile.
Which again, they were not like, they weren't eagle-eyed. The guy was doing 90 basically backwards.
Right.
Like he was basically parallel parking down the highway at 90 miles an hour. And they were just like, well, time to do the bare minimum of our jobs. And then a folder fell out of his car that just said in big red letters, going to do dangerous terrorism. How to do terrorism, part one. And then they were like, we should probably tell literally anybody that any of this happened. And then the police are like, commendation.
They gave him an award for it.
Yeah.
Congratulations. Congratulations to Chips. Hanging, and you can just practically feel like as soon as the thing cuts, you can feel like Larry Wilcox being like, so we get paid for the full week, right?
Yeah,
we're still getting paid for everything, right? Like our normal rate.
All right, so has the time come to ask the question, would you greenlight this show?
No, I mean, maybe actually.
Marty?
With significant changes.
Marty?
Yeah?
Is this podcast a safe place?
Yeah.
I would greenlight the fuck out of this show. I would watch 4 fucking seasons. 4-7. I would watch so much of this show. I want to watch every episode of this racist, horrible dog shit. I want to know who the other two 4-7 members. I want to know what they do in season 4 when the ratings start to flag. I want to know, like, what their cousin Jonathan is. Like, what desperate shit they pull. Oh, God. I want to live a life with it. 4-7, I briefly had a Firefly moment with where I was like, I wonder what could have been.
I feel like you could have gotten that.
Yeah.
At least, like, a Firefly amount of episodes. If they hadn't done the Chips thing. I don't know why they squeezed this into Chips. Like, we have... In the 80s, we had summer replacement shows. That's been a thing that's existed for a long time. A TV show that you just put on just for the summer. You don't expect it to get a lot of ratings. Like, you could have put this in the time slot. Don't worry, Chips is coming back. But from the creators of Chips, it's 4-7. And just giving them like 12 episodes just to air over the summer.
Yes.
That would have been fine. Whatever.
Okay.
Why would they do the Chips thing?
I'm going to get this show greenlit, and it's super easy. You don't do the Chips thing, because it's season 5 of Chips. Probably not as many people are watching.
Not as many people are watching, and the people that are watching aren't going to like this, because it's very far removed from what Chips is.
You just do a limited season of it, and you just call it Ninja Cops.
Just call it Ninja Cops, man.
And oh my God, it is going to happen. Especially if it's like during the off season where people are like, what the fuck is on? Ninja Cops? Yes. Yes, I will watch that over the Love Boat. Absolutely. It is such a layup. Greenlit in seconds.
So yeah, I can see why someone would do Ninja Cops. 4-7, man, is if they're all like this, I don't know. I think I would tap out pretty fucking fast. So that's it for Chips for 4-7. Jesus Christ, what a bad idea. What a just a complete misfire on all cylinders. I don't have any more to say on this. Subscribe to our Patreon for bonus episodes and getting episodes earlier and extended cuts. And also our Substack, where we're writing about very odd subjects. Like, I wrote about the time that Marvin Gaye wrote the most divorced guy album of all time.
I did my pitch for how we should restart society because parallel parking is bad. So, a lot of content.
If you want to hear more from us, join our Substack. There's links in there. Patreon.com/BreakingMayberry. Email us BreakingMayberry@gmail.com. And follow us on Blue Sky on the rare occasion that we Blue Sky on there. Breaking Mayberry at bsky.com. Man, that's really hard to say.
Can you hear the disdain in Marty's voice at the idea of us of you following us on Blue Sky? social media is dying. Yeah.
Do the Substack. I think that's it for us. We'll see you all down at California Interstate 5.
We are behind you, pursuing you. You don't have to follow us. We're following you at high speeds. Look in your rearview mirror if you're listening to this while driving. Me and Marty are fast approaching.
Time to play the Chips theme, which, by the way, slaps.
Kicks ass.
Chips theme kicks ass. We'll play it now.